policy, it's very important that the police serve the people, the community, the society generally, and are not serving private partisan interests. Yeah, it's, in a democracy it's very important that the police are subject to democratic control. We can't have a police service which is out of control, which is pursuing its own interests rather than the interests of the people. So that's very important to have that appropriate democratic control on the one hand. But on the other hand, there is concern that that democratic control is exercised by politicians who often have, or normally have, partisan affiliations. And equally in a democracy, it's very important that the police serve the people, the community, the society generally, and are not serving private partisan interests. So one of the constraints on that democratic control is to ensure that politicians in government or out of government are not directing the police to deploy their resources against their political opponents or dissidents in ways which undermine democratic rights, civil rights, human rights, etc. So the trick, which is difficult to achieve, is to balance this desire on the one hand for appropriate democratic control of the police, and on the other hand to protect society from a police which is operating in a partisan way and in an oppressive way against opponents of the government or dissidents or whatever. This is not easy to achieve, and various mechanisms and institutions have been put in place to try and balance this and make sure that both politicians and the police understand how this relationship is going to work. So in some countries, like New Zealand for instance, they have attempted to legislate this relationship, and that's true in Queensland where I live as well. In others it's been a case of developing a legal regime through the courts, and that's largely been the case in the UK for instance. And to some extent it's become a case of constitutional custom or convention. There's all kinds of different ways to ensure this. None of them is foolproof. None of them is proof against people who are determined to use the police or abuse the police in a way which oppresses citizens' rights and citizens' liberties. I gather there's been a long history, probably dating back to the imperial days in India, when the police have been used, if you like, as a ruler's or a regime police rather than as a democratic community police. So under those circumstances, I think it's very important that there be some clear delineation of the proper relationship between the police and the government. Of course, putting it in a statute or mandating it through a court judgment is just the beginning. You've got to develop a culture in which it's going to be respected and implemented. But I think having it, if you can agree on statutory provisions, this has some benefit because it gives everybody an opportunity to point to that delineation and say this is how it's supposed to be. And of course if it's in the law, then people who are victims of abuses have some recourse through the courts to say, this behavior by the police or this behavior by a police minister or what have you is a violation of the law and is a violation of our human rights or our constitutional rights. So it's helpful in that way. What we must not, the trap we must not fall into is the idea that once you've got it in the law, that's it, it's fixed. It's not, of course, because laws provide the framework, but for them to be effective, they have to be properly implemented and respected. And there's no guarantee of that.